thing, I would be like way. Site in January, and this is as transparent of a presentation as I could do of what we actually did, the numerous things that we fucked up, specifically that I fucked up, and what has actually worked that might potentially be useful. Oh, cool. Awesome. Okay, so just briefly, I used to run we called it the acquisition team at LivingSocial, basically fancy word for, you know, online marketing. We had a team of about 15. LivingSocial was a little unique, I think, in that our primary focus really was more on paid channels and on referral programs, and less so, at least initially, on content. So this content stuff is sort of new to me. It's kind of funny to me. I'm following guys on stage, including the presentation right before me, and I like read their stuff and like have been using their tips and lists to try and figure this stuff out. So I'm really not an expert in this. So we're learning as we go. So I'm a co-founder of CourseSupport.com. I'll tell you what that is in a second. And this is a really stupid last bullet, but I think that business stock photography is really funny. So I try and work it into as much of my life as possible. So let's begin. Like, who does cross shakes? It's just, okay. So CourseSupport.com. So it is a, you know, aggregator, TripAdvisor-esque site focused on the programming boot camp space, the nascent programming boot camp space. So dev boot camp is probably the biggest one. I know it's a, you know, big thing here in San Francisco, especially. It is very much, at least initially, a content or organic search play. You know, we're trying to be a lead generator for these schools, so we need high intent, high value traffic. I know of no better place to find said traffic than via organic search. So that's what we're like very focused on. Okay, so we're still like super small. Now, to be fair to myself, it's kind of a niche category, whatever, but like those lines are good. They're going the right way so far, but they're still pretty small. So, you know, that should color everything I say. I may not know what I'm talking about. By the way, the bottom line is actually the only thing I look at, which is our traffic from search. Like, I don't really care about overall traffic because and I think we touched on this a lot. Like, any given day, you know, if we get a retweet or something, it can be really big for overall traffic. It's meaningless. But the focus on organic search is because it's, you know, consistent, repeatable. So this is a site. I was in Charleston when I took the screenshot. And it's all a responsive site. I think there's really no reason why any new site shouldn't be responsive at a minimum. Maybe you'd have an MDOT if you really need to. So this is like using the Bootstrap framework. It's really simple. Our traffic's probably like 50-50 mobile web. So we have like a directory. It's cool. The schools or the boot camps have their own pages, obviously. So that's cool. You know, written descriptions, et cetera. We have, you know, blog posts. That's like obviously a lot of what we do. The blog post can be tagged for the schools, so they link back to the schools. Snippets of the content are pulled onto the schools' pages, so that's all good. So at this point, I'm like, all right, I fucking nailed this. Like, I wrote the requirements, the thing's up, you know, it's going well. This, by the way, is my favorite business stock photo. And I was like feeling pretty good about this stuff, because again, like, this is not really my background. Like, I'm learning. But okay. We're getting to my first mistake. So we had all these entities, right? It's a relatively simple model, schools, and they have locations and courses and so on. So I thought, oh, okay, well, it's super easy in Rails to, like, you know, create pages or page types. So let's just give these things pages. Why not? Any one of them could rank, and that'll be good for us. That was dumb. That was my mistake. And this guy, notably, he's like crumpled up lots of stuff, but he has a computer too. Like, I don't know what he's working on. Okay. So the problem was, you know, it turned out that the location pages, the course pages, et cetera, were very duplicative. Like, I didn't really think about the fact that how could I populate these things with unique content? And like, it was just overcomplicated. It didn't really make much sense. And so I was getting all these warnings and webmaster tools saying, hey, you know, this is duplicative. This page and this page is duplicative. And second, when we were getting inbound links, which is sort of the holy grail, they were being spread across these different pages. Like, someone might be linking to the San Francisco location of Dev Bootcamp, and others might be linking to the Dev Bootcamp page. And that obviously is not a great thing to do. And again, they really were very similar. And here's my rationale for why I did it. It was just easy, and I didn't know what I was doing. So, okay. So that was mistake one. And this is how we solved it. We got rid of all those pages, shocking. We collapsed all of those, that model down into a single place. So this is actually like a location, a course has a section, but we just smushed it all down together and all of that content now sits on the school pages. And we saw, like, this is not surprising, but we saw a big impact on our rankings and traffic almost immediately once these pages started to get indexed. So I think the lesson there is maybe be a little bit more thoughtful than I was about whether or not you need certain pages and they merit that like top level billing, because in some cases it might actually make more sense to be more conservative or have fewer pages that are deeper and you know not so shallow, because net those are the things that you really want to have rank. You don't necessarily need like massive breadth. Okay, so this is my second one. So this is the directory again. It's basically like search results. I mean, it's filterable, you know, nothing revolutionary here. So filter search results, that's cool. So I was like, oh, okay, cool. Well, you know, all these different permutations of the search results can get indexed. And then, you know, I'll just have like more pages that can rank. So for all these like random query combinations that I'm maybe didn't pick up in my keyword research, like I'll just rank for this stuff. Oh, awesome. So again, I was kind of thinking, oh, breadth is like really important or what I should be focused on. But not that, you know, that was a problem. Like this is a real example. So in the top one is like a search result page basically that ended up competing with our actual city pages. So when someone searches for a programming bootcamp in New York, I want that New York page to rank. That's where my content is. The problem was I wasn't really giving Google the right sort of direction about which is the best or most important New York page. So like these literally would like swap in search results depending on when you did it. And I was hurting myself in the process. So my second idea, and this like really demonstrates that I was figuring this out as I go, and I still am. My second idea was, okay, I'll use this canonical URL, canonical tag. And basically, if you guys aren't familiar, it's like a way to tell Google that these pages are basically the same thing, that they're, you know, they shouldn't be treated as distinct, even if they are. But that wasn't exactly right. I mean, you know, they weren't exactly the same. You know, different permutations of search results were different. So it wasn't really the right use of a canon tag, although not, you know, it's a lot closer to right, I think. Okay, so then finally what we did was, we'll just no index the whole search results, like section of the site. So none of it's gonna get crawled, you know, it's not gonna show up in any of the index stuff. And that was better. You know, that's a simple solution and it's pretty common as far as I can tell. So I felt okay about that. But really what I think, what we're working on now and what hopefully would be useful to you guys is, you know, really like the common filters that people were going into this directory or their common search results or, you know, queries that they're putting into our site, that's just people saying like, this is the content that we're most interested in or, you know, that's most useful to us. So what we're working on now is like, okay, well, why not have built out pages in response to those common filters or those common queries that we can populate with additional content. So just to give you a specific example, so like, you know, if we see a lot of people looking for Rails in New York, those are just parameters that are filtering on the directory, right? We're not really doing anything different other than swapping out the schools. But really where I want to be is if that's such an important, you know, if that's such an important combination, I should have a static page that Google can find that has relevant content for Rails programs in New York. Like there's no clearer signal that you could imagine that, you know, people want that information and that they might be searching for it also, other than like the fact that people are searching for it on your site. So that's where we're moving. We're gonna pull as many of those really important or common searches or param combinations into their own unique pages that actually have unique content. And I'm really confident that that will be a lot better than what we're doing today, although we will see. We'll check back at the next conference and I'll let you know. Okay, so those are my two like really dumb, like sort of 101 site development problems. So I just want to talk about like what kind of content we've been creating and some of the pros and cons, at least from my perspective. So these are like the main buckets that I came up with. So guides. So by guides, I mean like probably longer form, like, you know, how to pick a programming bootcamp, like really editorially driven. Those are good. You know, they take time and frankly, they require a lot of thought. Like, you know, you have to like think of stuff, write the guide. It's not just like fast, but they're, you know, appreciated by users generally speaking. And they're great to use for email capture. Hey, you know, get access to this guide, very common. So guides are like, okay, maybe we'll focus on those. Lists, I don't even have to say it, but you know, everybody does lists. Like for example, ours is all, our site's about getting people who want to become programmers. So, you know, you might think, oh, well, do a list of like the best books to learn Ruby on Rails or whatever. The problem is that's really easy to do. And so it's unbelievably competitive. So we haven't really focused on lists, which is kind of counterintuitive, although the site itself is kind of a list, just because I don't think we can really compete. Editorial, again, it's sort of in the same category of guides in my mind. It just requires a lot of thought. User-generated content is great, and we actually are starting to get a UGC like review content from students who've gone to these programs, which is like the whole point. So that's awesome, but it's kind of chicken and the egg thing. Like we don't have a lot of traffic yet, and so that would take a long time to really get there just on that alone. So interviews. So this is our focus, and this is another one of my stupid screenshots. So we found that interviews are a home run, and maybe it's unique to our business, but I really don't think so. So a couple pros of interview content. So they're really, really easy to produce. If you have a phone and the ability to record said phone call in like 20 minutes, someone you can interview, bang, you've got an interview. And it's going to be almost always interesting. So we're interviewing, in our case, students and teachers and the founders of these programs, hiring managers, other engineers, and their thoughts on this category. But I think you could apply that same logic to interviewing your customers and why they like the product or whatever, you know, depending on your vertical. So I believe they're universally applicable, and they're actually, you know, our users actually engage with these things at a really high rate. And again, maybe it's unique to us, but I don't think so. And potentially they're good link bait because, you know, when you interview so-and-so of Dev Bootcamp, you know, there's a possibility that at least Dev Bootcamp might want to link to the fact that their person has been interviewed on this site. You know, so maybe they help you generate backlinks. The one pain is that, you know, generally speaking, you're recording these things and then you have to like actually write them up and edit them. That's a huge pain in the ass. It takes forever. And listening to, I don't know if anyone's ever done this, but listening to an interview on like half speed five times over as you transcribe it is truly mind-numbing. I just want to point out, they are engaging. It's like impossible to see these numbers, but basically all of our newsletters are these, is this interview content, and our open rates are like, you know, 40-50%, click-throughs are like 10-20% on these emails. So just that's one data point, but I mean, I think that interviews are quite relevant to our audience. They seem to like them at least. So one other tip on the interview piece, we started using Elance and Odesk to do the transcription. And so now we kind of have this content generation. I'm assuming you're familiar, yeah, okay, cool. So now we have this this like machine and like a formula that we can really scale to produce high quality content that seems to resonate with our audience, and we can really increase our output because we, you know, leverage Elance and Odesk. And just a couple other points. So I would try a couple people on the site because some of them are better than others, especially, you know, if you're doing English language stuff. You know, it's really cheap. Like $5 to $10 max per hour for someone really good, potentially even less. A lot of these guys will turn these things around really fast. So like in a couple hours, we'll have something back that we've sent over. And so, you know, we're able to do like potentially, you know, 5-10 interviews a day on the phone. get them transcribed, and then we can publish them as we see fit over the course of the next, you know, week or two. Whereas if we were trying to create a comparable amount of just content based on our own research, our own writing, it would take way, way longer. And I actually think this is better. So I know, I'll stop talking about interviews, I promise. But anyway, try it, give it a shot. Okay, so quickly on link building. I don't know, how much time do I have left? 5 minutes? Okay, perfect. Okay, so obviously, you know, when you do link building, you're supposed to do conquesting. That's what all the blogs say. So we did that. We have a couple small competitors. We looked at who was linking to them. We contacted those people. Yeah, it's fine. I mean, you know, that only goes so far, particularly in a kind of nascent category. Guest blogging, we talked about that. Kind of a quasi-controversial topic, but we've had some success with it. You know, some of our sort of players in our space, the schools themselves will let us guest blog. There are some adjacent niches to our business, and I think this is another potentially relatable thing, that are interested in our point of view, like career sites, for example, are kind of interested in this space. So we've had some success in reaching out to those guys and saying, hey, we want to, you know, write about this bootcamp thing and how people are getting jobs, et cetera. And then like the women in tech or diversity sites, you know, in the technology space are interested in this category. So I don't think guest blogging is, you know, dead. I think it's quite worthwhile. It has worked for us. Okay, and then this is like pretty much my last big thing. So what we've really had the most success with in terms of generating backlinks are long form reports. So basically original research, the two main ones we've done so far are surveys. In this case, we surveyed the boot camps themselves. In one we released on Tuesday, actually, we surveyed graduates of these programs. And, you know, and we were trying to figure out this is a market sizing report. It's impossible to see the graduates things about, you know, how much money are people making? Are they getting jobs, et cetera? These take a lot of work, honestly. They probably, you know, we've been working on this last one for the last 2 months. But for that first release, we put this thing out. We had never been covered before on any of these tech blogs. We had no prior contacts at any of these places, really nothing to draw on. And we got like 14 really solid links. Those are the bigger names. I think TechCrunch was on there too. That just wrote about the research, and that was really awesome. And another nice thing about these like long form research projects, if you can come up with something like it, is that through no doing of our own, they continue to draw pretty good high quality backlinks, you know, that are referring to them every single week. So we got one a couple days ago saying, oh yeah, you know, CourseBoard said blah 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 this industry, and then a full, you know, full article about the space. From writers that we don't even know. So, you know, it's like they're not evergreen in the sense that, you know, they are timely. We were estimating the size of the market in 2014, but they have a long shelf life if they're good enough. A couple tips on the report stuff. So we made a massive contact list. You know, we don't have a PR firm or anything. So of just people who've written about this category before that we wanted to reach out to. And we basically got 1 out of 10 actually wrote a story. So that was my experience. I don't know if that would be the same, but I think you probably want to have a pretty big list. I mean, there's really no reason for it to be small. By that report is actually like a PDF that was on our site. We had a blog post summarizing it too. That seemed to add like a level of credibility with some of the reporters that I think helped us, because it's like, oh, you have to like download this thing and it's like PDF, seems sort of academic. So maybe that's something to consider. We also have made a point to, whenever possible, reference other original research. So other studies, you know, that you're sort of putting yourself in the neighborhood of like more credible organizations that have been around for a long time. And I think that also helped, because again, you know, this goes without saying, but we're just trying to get the reporters to think that we're not a joke in order to give our content a shot and you know, a read. Okay, so quick takeaways and I'm done here. Hopefully maybe you could remember one of these things. So maybe a simpler page structure to start would have helped us. I think it would have. You know, think about static pages that users are potentially really interested in. You know, a lot of sites, it's really easy to build sites that are largely parameter driven, you know, in order to bring content in and out. But, you know, static pages are really great for SEO purposes. So I wish we had been more sort of cognizant of that. You know, find pockets of content that are both really high quality and also easy to produce. Again, I think interviews, at least for us, sort of nail that. And then finally, you know, long form content, the reports I mentioned are really worth it. I'm extremely confident of that. The one we put out on Tuesday got in the Wall Street Journal. We were in Fast Company. We're in a bunch of others this week. And that's awesome. Like, in terms of our overall domain authority, you know, that will have a big impact, maybe not tomorrow, but over the course of the next couple months. And one more time, like, we're still really small. I may be full of shit. You know, we'll see. And that's it. So lastly, so if you're interested in bootcamp, coursesupport.com. I actually, with a partner, host like meetups and conferences for like growth hackery type people. It's grow.co if you want to be on the email list. And if you are really smart about SEO stuff, and you see something that we're doing wrong, please tell me, because I'm confident that you're right. And that's my email. Okay, cool. Thank you.